Okay, chapter 21, Gospel of John. Finishing up. Oh, notes are in the back. Notes are in the back. I did not enhance the notes at all, since that enhanced it. But I will this week. All right, the Gospel of John, chapter 21. Father, bless our lesson today, the nourishment that it gives us, the faith, of the increase of our faith. Father, in the knowledge of your word, the drawing closer to our Savior. Father, in the expectation of your return. Now, Lord, we pray for that. In Christ's name, amen. All right. Last week we began this. Notes are in the back. Notes are in the back. John 21. The types that we, without, if you don't want to cheat or look at your notes, the types, we had the sea, the shore, the ship, the net, and the fish. The sea, the shore, the ship, the net, and the fish. Now, there could be other things in there beyond that, but those are some pretty obvious ones. The sea represents the world. The shore would represent heaven. The ship would represent, they were in a ship, the church. The net would represent the gospel, and the fish would represent the souls that are saved. All right, and then we did this, the story ends how it begins, comparing John 21 to Luke 5. When they begin with the Lord, not that's the first point that they met the Lord, but they left for Sokol, took up with the Lord. It's still the boat story. There's a lot of good boat stories in the Bible. There's always a good story out of those. The very first time you guys ever came here, I preached it. And then I preached it again when you guys were gone. I figured, well, you're gone, so I preached it again. Yeah, the service you came, I preached the boat story and the increasing of your faith. Boat one, they were Jesus was in the boat when they first met him, so they had little faith. Then they invited Jesus in the boat because he was walking on the water. And so that was more faith. And then when Peter got out of the boat, that's more faith, right? So getting out of the boat, that's faith, right? So every boat story intensified. And it was the increasing of their faith. I forget what the title is, Building Faith or something like that. And it goes in order like that, that the faith increases. All right, well, comparing it is, it begins and ends the same. They're very similar. They're either direct parallels or direct opposites. And it's kind of like the Bible circle, Genesis and Revelation, the beginning and the end. We call that the Bible circle. It begins and ends the same. You know, the tree of life, they're separated from it, and now they're joined to it, the beginning of the book to the end of the book. All right? And then this is where we pick it up here, is this this big, long outline. The showing of Jesus. They were to go to Galilee. So in verse 1 here, the showing of Jesus, after these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. Now on this wise showed he himself. Now we already covered this last week. Is John 6:1, it states that the Sea of Tiberias is Galilee, the Sea of Galilee. And where and they're commanded to go to Galilee. Mary, he tells Mary, tell them to go to Galilee. I'll meet them there. So Galilee, the Sea of Tiberias, and then the other Sea of Tiberias in Gennesaret, the Lake Gennesaret. Is that how it's pronounced? All one in the same place, in or called the same. Tiberias and Gennesaret are on the shore of the same. So there, it's given different names for the same lake. We said, where the Edmund Fitzgerald went down in the, was that Lake Superior?
Yeah.
Lake Superior, and the Indians call it Gitchagimi or something like that.
Yeah.
Gitchagumi. So a lake can have different names. All right. So and we showed that, the showing of Jesus. They were to go to Galilee. Galilee. All right. The restoration by Jesus. And we did look at this. I think this is where we left off. There were together Simon Peter, Thomas called Didymus, and Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and two other of his disciples. The restoration. Thomas is in the group. Now, let's see, five of these guys are named. Peter, Thomas, Nathanael, and the sons of Zebedee, two. And who are they? John and James, yes. And so even though their names are not given, it says the sons of Zebedee. And they're called what? The sons of?
Thunder.
Thunder. And what was it? Their name? Starts with a B. Barnager or something. Yeah, meaning sons of thunder. Yes. All right. And so the restoration. Now, when we get to here, we say, look at how backslid they are. And we're going to see that too. But notice Thomas is in the group. Thomas was not in the group before that. Verses 24 through 28 is where Thomas is not there. And so the idea there, losses by neglect make us more careful not to let opportunities to slip by. So generally speaking, it's the service that you missed, right? We've been there. It's like there was the only time that our preacher preached on a funeral. What do you call it? Oh, cremation as a topic. I've only heard it. I should say, it was only given once, cremation. Is it biblical, not biblical, or does it not matter? Now, you know, people can have preferences and convictions, but, pardon? Doesn't matter to you. Now, for some other people, it could really matter. It was the only time I've ever heard it mentioned, and it was preached on a Sunday evening as a topic. We were still meeting in a Masonic lodge. That night, in the afternoon, we were at my mother-in-law's, which was over on Skylark, which was over by York and by the Nike site. And what happened that night? Do you recall? I remember the season. Yeah, there was a snowstorm. And we were going to be late for church, so we said, we got to get out of here. And the in-laws were still not getting used to this. Because they're Roman Catholics. And Roman Catholics, they do their one service. They show up whenever that is, Saturday night or whatever. And they still weren't not getting the hang of that. We were not going to be there. Because Sunday, you're going to do what they all do. And, you know, it's family night, and you're just going to fellowship and or do whatever they do. We left, but we never made it. We missed that night. And I wish I'd never missed that night to hear what he had said about that. And we didn't get the tape. I don't even know if there were tapes. Maybe not at that point. There may not have been a point to get that. But if you've ever missed another service, you do miss services, right? It would always seem as they, if you weren't in the service, if she was somewhere else other than in the service. One time at Cleveland Baptist, we showed up. It was Wednesday night. Now, what do you do Wednesday night at a Baptist church? You pray, right? Well, it's this huge church, and we did not participate, or we weren't really invited to participate. So the only, this is only one example. And not to say the wife purposely was not in the auditorium. She was in the nursery. And I don't even know why you were in the nursery. Oh, you had to be. Yeah, you had a turn or something. But she's there, they're all blabbing. And they weren't really praying, they were blabbing. And there's this closed circuit in there. And there may be more than one nursery, but for Wednesday night, there might only be the one nursery. For Wednesday night, because usually it's pretty sparse, or more sparse than a regular service. Well, of all services, the pastor calls my name out. You know, I was shocked. And he said, would you come forward and pray? And I said, I would. It was shocking. So I went forward, and I think there was two of us that were going to pray. And so I was up there, and all the women are in there, and they're just talking. And then one of the women say, isn't that your husband up there? And they were all kind of shocked, and she's looking and said, no, it can't be. No, it's not him. No. And then the other one says, no, it is your husband. And she looks again, no, it can't be. It isn't him. It turned out it was me. And everybody was shocked. And so I prayed and so on. But usually the only time she was not in the auditorium is when something happened. It always works out that way. Whenever she wasn't in the auditorium, something would happen that was unusual. So in this case, Thomas, I'm just using that as an illustration. Thomas wasn't going to miss another event just in case something did happen, right? He missed the other event where the Lord shows up and he wasn't there. So he wasn't about to miss another opportunity. So the restoration by Jesus, once a person gets backslid and restored, he does not want to let other opportunities slip by. That's a pretty good rule of thumb. You know, those that are committed will tend to do that. That they will be all the more committed. Like, you know, you don't want to miss the rapture, right? We don't want to miss that. And not that you'll miss it, but you know what I'm saying. You don't want to miss something. Something could happen. All right, verse 3. The fruitfulness apart from Jesus, the showing of Jesus, the restoration by Jesus, the fruitlessness apart from Jesus. If the Lord's not on soul winning with you, you're not going to catch any fish. I remember one time we were up the street here, and we go soul winning, and it's really rare to catch a fish, to catch a soul, to get someone to pray. We have certain goals. First of all, are they home? A lot of times you go soul winning, either they don't answer the door, they'll send the wife to answer the door. Or they're not home. A lot of times there's a lot of no-shows. They're not there. But if they are there, you want to try to strike up a conversation. You find commonality. And there's certain goals. Will they answer the door? If they answer the door, one other goal would be you want to get the track in their hand. They say, no, I don't want that. Well, we continue on. And they don't want the tray or the packet. No. Just give it to somebody else. We don't want it. And then on and on, we talk and talk. And then I'll go back to that. Are you sure you don't want this? I said, listen, just read it over. And generally, that goal is met. We finally get it in their hand, get it in their house. That way they're without excuse. We get the tray in their hand, the packet's in their hand. Now, if you get invited in, that's a big goal. first time I went on soul winning, in one church, it was not a good situation. I don't even want to talk about it. It was not good. But I was not afraid to go soul winning. I was already older. I already met all kinds of people through business, so I wasn't afraid to talk to people. So I didn't have to overcome those things. And then we find the friendliest people are either the poorest people, and I always liken it unto, I liken it unto economics. Poor people aren't afraid to talk to you because they have nothing to lose. Mm-hmm. You're not going to get their money because there's no money to get. Mm-hmm. Rich people, I find rich people are not afraid to talk to you. Rich people, they're salesmen, they're blabbing to other people all the time, directing things. They're not afraid to talk to you because, and I always liken it unto economics, is they already know that I'm not going to get their money. I'm not going to get their money. So they're not afraid to do that. Middle class is a little tougher. That's a little tougher. But lower middle class, I always find that is the hardest, is they're afraid the little they do have, they'll lose. And they seem to be the least friendliest. If you put them in four classes, lowest is the most friendly, rich is very friendly, middle class, if it's lower middle class, they're the least friendly, and middle class upper is sort of friendly. And so we go out and we try to win a soul. The very first door I ever knocked on at Cleveland Baptist with, I can't remember his name right now. No, it was the guy that did the magic tricks. He was on bus too. It was bus visitation. We were in the projects. We were in a, you were not along that. I was paired up with him. It was the very first door. And did not see the person. But what did they say? They said, come in. And I was stunned. Because you're not accustomed to that. We walked right in. And it went really well. It was all the way up to, they were going to pray. And then it was a woman. And then her husband came home. And that just, right at that moment. And everything just fell apart after that. But fruitfulness. Without me, as it says there, is I am the true vine in John 15. You want to be fruitful. Without me, ye can do nothing. In verse 3 there, I go fishing. He says that they fished all that night and caught nothing. Oh, I know what we said. We did talk about that. Is when do you tend to catch most fish? Night fishing. See, these are professional fishermen. They know when to fish. And I think some of it has to do with lunar and barometric pressure. My dad would follow that in the paper like anything in the PD years ago. And I guess if we're looking for fall, it says here in verse 3, they went forth and entered into a ship immediately. And I guess you could jump to the conclusion, it makes for good preaching. As they did it immediately, they did not pray. They did not pray ahead of time. Now, even though you go soul winning and you personally don't land a fish, the fact that you get literature out, you get a tract in someone's hand, all those things are important. I remember one time we were out with a guy named Lamar Chenault. That's quite a name, Lamar Chenault. I think he was from Alabama. Originally, he went to Ruckman School. He was a graduate. He was in town, staying for an overnight meeting, and he was from New York, I think Buffalo area. And I remember a soul got saved up the street here. It seems like it was up the street here in this area. And he said, it was near the end. They said, why should we quit? The fish are biting. But, they caught one. The fisher biting.
Yeah, I never forgot him saying that.
The fisher biting. And so when the fisher biting, I could look at a bobber all day long if there's no fish in there. I could throw a line in a fishless fishing hole and watch that bobber from now to Tuesday. I can, you know. So anyway, fruitlessness apart from Christ. Christ is not there. Verse 4, the position of Jesus. But when the morning was now come, Jesus stood on the shore. All right, but the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. Oh, where else was he standing when he's in heaven? Give me another time. He was standing. Anybody recall? Book of Acts?
Stephen.
Yes, you're right, Stephen. When Stephen is being stoned. That we say that he is ready at that point. If they accept, this is one thought, that if those Jews, Stephen preaches, if they accept what Stephen preached, that the second coming would have occurred at that point. He was ready to come back. Obviously, they rejected him and stoned him, but that's where Jesus also was standing. Let's go to these verses here. John 6. John 6 there, that is the feeding of the 5,000. All right, now I guess the topic there is he's on the shore. Yeah, and they willingly received him into the ship, willingly received Jesus into the ship. You know, behold, I stand at the door and knock, right? That's directed towards Christians. Received into the ship. Remember, the ship is a type of the church. And immediately, the ship was at the land whither they went. I mean, what a miracle, man. Immediately, that's a type of the, would be a type of the rapture. Immediately, you're in heaven. And, you know, there's all kinds of miracles. Usually they don't talk about it. Usually you don't hear that as a miracle, but that's a miracle. Jesus did all kinds of it. John, let's since we're in John there, let's stay in John. John 11. John 11, 25 and 26. Jesus said unto them, oh, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Those that are dead in Christ across the street, and whosoever liveth and believeth in me, all right, that's us now who are still alive, shall never die. Believest thou this? We never die. We will be raptured out of here. You got the rapture there, a type of that. Another one would be John 10. Go to John. Oh, yeah, I do have it there. John 10. I got this guy, this one from a guy from Arkansas. I can't remember their names. Remember, it was husband and wife and they had some kids. They were homeschoolers. They came up from Arkansas. His pastor came back up here to pick them up, to take them back. They were really struggling up here. They went back to the Ozarks. Little tiny church, and the pastor came up here with a U-Haul and got them. Do you remember their names? Yeah, they were the nicest people. But he gave me this one. Verse 9, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. In, meaning the rapture, we go into heaven at the second phase of the second coming. We come back out with him, where every eye sees him, and find pasture is the millennium. In is the rapture, out is the second phase of the second coming, and the pasture is the millennium. All right, so the position of Jesus being there in heaven. Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4, verse 36. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship. And there were also with him other little ships. All right, so he's in the ship there, other little ships. There was a good one about that. A little ship. John, that's coming up here. John comes in a little ship. and he stays with the fish. So a little congregation and the little bit of and the fish, he's faithful to the fish. He doesn't forsake them. Isn't that what David did? Remember, what did one of the brothers complain to David about the sheep in the story of David and Goliath? Yeah, the older brother complained. I know your heart, your naughty heart. And what did he say to David about the sheep that David was supposed to be tending? Pardon? That he left them. All right, so if David is a type of Jesus, he leaves the sheep, he left us. Now, he said he'd come to us, so in spirit he comes to us. He left the sheep, but it does say, if you look, he leaves them with somebody to care for the sheep. He just did not abandon them. That someone, in fact, why don't we just go there? What is that? That's 1 Samuel 17. I'm pretty sure it says that he leaves the sheep with somebody. Anybody see that now? Let me know. Pardon?
Verse 20.
David rose up early in the morning and left the sheep with a keeper. All right, well then who's the keeper? I would say that's the pastor. Yeah. He leaves the sheep with a keeper and took and went. All right. And I think he complains about that. Does he complain about it? Maybe I'm wrong. He does not mention that? No, I meant the brother. Verse 28, left those few sheep. Notice it's few. Listen, folks, those words are in there. Right? Are there few that be saved? He calls them little flock, and they're few that be saved, folks. Only God can write a book like this. Right? It's all the way through this. All right, back if you would. All right, so the shore is heaven, the sea is the world. Physically, we say they're backslid, that they returned to the world, and they were exercising the flesh and not the spirit there. All right, verse 5. The confession to Jesus. Then Jesus saith unto them, children, have ye any meat? They answered him, no. I mean, they're truthful about it. What is that, Philippians 4:19? But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory, right? 2 Corinthians 12. Isn't that the, that sounds like the thorn in the flesh. 2 Corinthians 12. Nine through 10. All right. And he said, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in thee. Verse 7 is the thorn. And then I have to be honest. I can't comment on that. We could comment on the Philippians, but my God shall supply all our need. Isn't that what Philippians 4:19? Right. In other words, they confess we have. Okay, I guess we could say we could confess we have no strength. We cannot do anything in our strength. But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Yeah, so have ye any meat? And so they're doing it in the flesh, and his grace is sufficient. He's going to supply what we have and what we need. All right, the command of Jesus in verse 6. He said unto them, cast the net on the right side of the ship, ye shall find. They cast, therefore, and now they were not able to draw from the multitude. All right, now, he is heard 300 feet away, verse 8. Look at what it says here. The other disciples came in a little ship, for they were not far from land. Now, it says not far from land, 300 feet. Now, if I had to swim that, folks, we're having a funeral. We're having a funeral. You know, I say that jokingly. Maybe I'd make it. But, you know, when you got to live, you'll do a lot to live, right? But as it were, 200 cubits. So how far is a cubit?
18 inches.
Well, if a cubit is supposed to be from here to here. So it depends on the side of the... But we generally round it off to a number, 18 inches. If you're in Europe, it is how many centimeters?
That's a half a meter.
Half a meter. Right, so it's 18 inches, a foot and a half times 200 of those, that's 300 feet. Now, my friend, I had a friend that was a greenskeeper, went to agronomy school. And if you're going to go to agronomy in Ohio, where would you go?
Ohio State,
yes, you're right. All right, you get the bonus points. You're right, you would go to Ohio State. Agronomy, it's the study of what?
Water.
Well, Iowa always called it grass. You know, it's agriculture. And if you're going to be a greenskeeper and that's what you want to do, you're going to study fertilizers, greens, application, and all that. And you're going to go there. So that's where he went to school for that. Anyway, he was down the street from me. He was the next door neighbor to the greenskeeper at Hawthorne Valley. And I figured he was a quarter of a mile away, but he wasn't really, it wasn't that far. A quarter mile is a little bit, it may have been an eighth of a mile, but I can whistle. I can put my fingers in my mouth. I can whistle without my fingers, with my fingers, and we can sound like a foghorn. And he would go home and I'd say, "Hey, Tom, see if you can hear me from there." So I'd whistle. I said, "Yeah, I you know, he'd call me and say, "Yeah, I can hear you from there." And, but 300 feet away to be heard, it's a football field. Yeah, football field. For some of you here, you're probably too, I'm not too timid to be heard 300 feet away. And to lift up thy voice as a trumpet. Where is that verse? What book? Lift up thy voice as a trumpet. Nope. That's okay. You're in the right area. Old Testament, Isaiah 58:1, 59:1. It's verse 1. Lift up thy voice as a trumpet. Some people just have a natural voice. It's either irritating, it can be very irritating. Is it 58:1? Okay, Isaiah 58:1. Lift up thy voice as a trumpet. Well, it can't be mousy. And our Lord was not mousy. You know, children, have ye any meat? Now, I'm not going to shout in here, but... 300 feet away is a little bit away. And I'm not saying it was to be heard from heaven, that's a miracle, but 300 feet, that's not a miracle. I mean, he shouted and he was heard. If you did that in nature, you would want something behind you, like rocks or something, to project the... You know, I tell people, let's say if you're going to do a special, you want to project your voice. Or let's say we do a wedding, and you're doing your vows. Sometimes I tell the bridegroom, I say, just turn just a little bit, even though you're saying it to your bride or your groom, you're still projecting your voice out at the people so they're heard. Because sometimes they get real shy, you know, and don't project their voice. But 300 feet away, you know, the command of Jesus. He is we could say infinity away, you know, in heaven right now, in the throne room. But we can still hear him through the book, right? Right? The power of the word. It's a very powerful thing. Thus saith the Lord. In that verse, thus saith the Lord. Verse 18, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Now, folks, they didn't have microphones. When was the first mic? Is that 19? When did they make the first ones? 1920, 30?
Well, they had microphones for radio, so probably the late teens.
The late teens?
Yeah.
Is that piezoelectric? Is that a quartz crystal?
Well, back then it was carbon.
Carbon. Well, somehow, however it works, it works. It projects the voice. Well, obviously, they didn't have that. If you were an orator, you had to, it's kind of like a singer. They're usually born with it. And then they can work on it and enhance it. But they're born. If you're not born with it, I mean, you just can't have that happen. Usually if somebody shouts and they're not accustomed to that, and then they not only shout, but they use their vocal cords, what could happen to them? Temporarily.
Go hoarse,
hurt them up. Yeah, and we call that what?
Laryngitis.
Laryngitis, yeah. They would get laryngitis. Psalm 19, verse 11. Psalm 19, the power of the word, the power of obedience. Now, when he came to Elijah in the cave, he came in what? That still small voice. It wasn't the thunder and the lightning and the earthquake and the fire. It was in a still small voice. So a lot of times a still small voice. I mean, Moses, when he cried, I would call that a still small voice, but it sure moved the heart of Pharaoh's daughter. Didn't it? Heavens declare the glory of God, right? Wasn't Saturday morning pretty glorious if you were driving around? It was, every painting of God is an original, right? There are no reproductions. Unless it's on film, it's, he destroys all originals. It's gone. You'll never have it that way again. Oh, he could paint it again, but every scene's going to be different. There'll be a slight difference to it, right? The power of obedience. Oh, I read a verse 11, one, but it's more verse 11. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is great reward by keeping the command. So they kept the command, and did they enclose a great amount of fish by keeping the command? He that soweth sparingly shall reap sparingly. You've got to have your line in the water. When I go fishing, let's say I take my grandchildren or my sons, or we take somebody else along, sometimes they're doing more getting their gear on. I'm pretty ready. You know, the bait goes out. We want to get that line out, the first line out. We get it out there, and you want to doodle around, but we get that line out there. We're fishing for big fish, which is a lot of times in the river, it's garbage fish, but we want the fun of catching them. But if your line's not wet, with bait on it, you're not going to catch anything, right? They're not going to jump in the boat. You got to get it out there. So if you obey, get your line, they were commanded to get the line out there, and then there'll be great reward. But if the line didn't go out, there's not going to be any reward. The power of the gospel. Romans 1:16, that's a good, that's a very good verse. Romans 1, verse 16, is the power of God unto salvation. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Now that's the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ, which is the grace of God. The gospel of the grace of God, Acts chapter 20. Which is the glorious gospel, which is 2 Corinthians 4, 4. Unto salvation, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. Only for those that believe, otherwise there's no power in it. To the Jew first and also to the Greek. All right, so the power of the word, power of obedience, the power of the gospel. It's not us, it's the net, the gospel that does the catching. Now, when we present it, always be ready to give an answer for of the hope that lieth within you. With what? Meekness and fear. Oh, I would use that word. With meekness and fear. You know, you could fudge that in there and find that in there. The way you present it is so important. You know, if you're on some have compassion, making a difference. Others save with fear. All right? So you first preach the love of Christ, and you want to make it, always want to make as many connections as you can. If you're talking to a Roman Catholic, how are we connected with them? We both believe in a virgin birth, right? Now, we don't believe in a perpetual virgin, but a virgin birth. We both believe that God created the heaven and the earth. Now, the Pope is a... that just shook me. This is 25 years ago or 20 years ago. I turned on, the Pope was a... and I'm not saying all Catholics believe what the Pope believes. What does he believe on creation? Yeah, is it called, is that what we term it? Theistic evolution. Meaning God created the amoeba and then the jellyfish evolved from there. You know, now I'm not saying every Pope believes that, and I'm not saying every Catholic believes that. Well, I think most Catholics, if they hear that, they think you're goofy. At least some of them. That God is the great creator, that God made this. So wherever you can make bridges, maintain those bridges. But then wherever you, then, you know, and that's the love part. That way they can listen to you. But wherever you can't agree, well, you can't agree. And then that some people just need to be told they're going to hell. Usually a prisoner that's in jail already knows he's going to hell. And he knows why he's going to hell. So you don't really have to emphasize that. Usually it's the one who thinks he's squeaky clean sometimes has to be told that. As the, you know, they can realize, well, yeah, Jesus did die for sins. Yeah, but it's, oh no, it's my sins. All right. So anyway, where are we at here? The position of Jesus. Oh, the power, the command of Jesus. Verse 7, back here to John 21. Therefore, that disciple, the discernment that it was Jesus. Therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved saith unto Peter, it is the Lord. So we were driving around. We had to go here and there yesterday. And the comment was made, isn't it pretty out? And basically, the wife and I both said, well, it is the Lord, right? Can't you see the power of God every day, someplace? It is the Lord. As soon as that great flood of fish came in, the first words out of John's mouth, it is the Lord. Successful labors. Boy, is successful one C or two C? I spelled it one C. It is the Lord. If you're successful in your labors for him, it is the Lord. Receiving of a blessing, it is the Lord. The receiving of mercies, it is the Lord. If you receive persecution, it is the Lord. You know, people, I've heard, I have never really heard good things about Eli, but we say he was a good man, but a weak man. I've heard that. He was a good man. He was a good man. Remember, he told Samuel, hey, if you don't tell me, you're toast. And he told him what the Lord, the curse that was to be upon his house. What did Eli respond? Does he say, let him do what seemeth good? He may have said, it is the Lord. Or let him do what seemeth him good. I mean, he accepted it. It is the Lord, right? David does the same thing. Eli, David. I just gave a couple examples. It is the Lord. It is the Lord. In other words, when persecution comes, the Lord permits that. And we say, well, it's not the devil. You know, the devil made me do it. The Lord permitted that. It is the Lord. Yeah, what is David?
He says, Eli says,
oh, he does. He says both. He says, it is the Lord. Let him do what seemeth good to him. Okay. He says both. It is the Lord. And we've got to discern the Lord working in our life every day. Right? Whether it's a near miss. I remember one time I had my 65 Chevelle. I was over there by Southgate. And somebody pulled out directly in front of me. It was heavy traffic. I know I've said this before. And it was the old power steering, the kind that is not assisted. The kind that you just go like this, and you don't even feel the steering. And it was my 65 Chevelle. And I remember the passenger seat. You didn't have to. What, seat belts were ropes, you know? There was no seat belt in that thing. And if it was shot. Yeah, that's a seat belt. Always. It was knee jerk. My dad always did that. Always. You know, that was just typical. When we were at that wedding, we were talking about, I was sitting across from an English comp teacher, and I said, oh, you know, big brought back nightmares. I said, my English comp teacher in college would take a big drag on the cigarettes. And back then, you smoked. Everybody was smoking. A big drag. And we were in Quonset huts at Cleveland State. They couldn't figure that out. They didn't know what a Quonset hut was. Man, well, these millennials don't know nothing. It takes this huge drag, looks at me and says, Mr. Tucker, and blow that smoke right out her nose, man. She had me terrified. But I said, if we're at a wedding like this, there will be ashtrays. Ashtrays are probably in an antique store. Or an ashtray, you know, the kind that are decorative. You know, they make them decorative. I said, there'd be ashtrays on every table. And everybody'd be huffing and puffing if you didn't want to smoke. I was not a smoker. You had to put up with it. Everybody's inhaling. And if it was 20 years before us in the 60s, they were really huffing and puffing. Right? I didn't even know why I brought that up. What are we at here? Pardon?
No, you're talking about it is the Lord.
Yeah, it is the Lord. What do they have to do? I can't remember now.
By the grace of God, we all have lung disease.
Yeah, I got on that. Oh, I was in traffic. I was driving. I'll never forget. It was directly in front of me, and she couldn't make it. This woman couldn't make it. And I remember, yeah, there was no seatbelts. The kid's face was in the passenger window. I was looking right at him. I could see his eyes were dilating already. And I did this. I was going to miss him. It turned that thing hugged the street, man. I did that. I weaved in, and I just missed a couple of cars. And I was crashing. I was probably going too fast. But I can look back and say, it is the Lord. It is the Lord. Right? Yeah. You have near misses, you say, thank God. Thank God. Right? I'm working on the saw. If you're working on the table saw and you feel the wind from the blade, it is the Lord. Father, bless now the preaching in Christ's name. Amen.